Animals Today, your home for serious talk about animals. I'm Dr. Lori Kirshner. In 1637, René Descartes declared that animals were soulless machines, and people had no obligation to treat them any differently from machines. This unfortunate doctrine persisted for centuries. The next notable milestone in the history of animal rights was in 1822 with the passage of the first serious animal welfare law in the United Kingdom. And in 1975, Peter Singer published Animal Liberation and ignited the modern animal rights movement we are a part of today. These events and many other true stories have been woven into a fascinating book by David Grimm called Citizen Canine, Our Evolving Relationship with Cats and Dogs. Filled with compelling personalities and interesting vignettes, David takes us on the journey of greater legal status for companion animals. So although Descartes performed experimental surgery on awake dogs, anyone trying that now would surely end up in jail. David Grimm is a deputy news editor at Science and teaches journalism at Johns Hopkins University. Welcome to the program, David.
Thank you for having me.
David, so certainly we have come a long way since the days of Descartes, and this is made very clear with a visit to the Duke Canine Cognition Center you described in your book. What happens there, and how does it illustrate the status our companion animals have attained in our society?
Well, one of the really fascinating things that's happened over the last 15 years is some really amazing insights into how dogs think. For a long time, in fact, for more than 100 years, dogs were considered sort of worthless in terms of scientific study subjects. Darwin was a big dog lover, and he thought dogs had a lot to teach us about empathy and morality. But after his time, dogs were considered not useful for science because they were domesticated, and the thinking went that you should only study wild animals. But about 15 years ago, a researcher named Brian Hare, who works at Duke University, and also a researcher named Adam McClosey, who works in Budapest, independently showed that dogs could understand what we mean when we point at something. So if I point at a cup that has a treat in it, dogs, and there's some other cups around that I don't point at, dogs will always go to the cup that we point at, and chimpanzees can't do that. And this suggested that dogs have a special type of social skill that maybe only humans and maybe a few other animals have, but even our closest relatives, chimpanzees, don't have. And this really started a big revolution. Now there's nearly a dozen labs around the world that study how dogs think. It's taught us that dogs possess certain types of cognition that potentially other animals don't possess, which is really fascinating. It's really given us an insight into their mind. Now, I'm a cat guy, and I went looking for people that study cats as well. And as any cat owner probably knows, they don't make the best scientific study subjects. So it's but cats actually do. In the one test that was done, cats actually do pass this pointing test as well, which means cats actually do outsmart chimpanzees as well in this test of social cognition. But what this is all telling us is that we're just learning a lot more about our companion animals than we ever knew before, and that's really helping us to elevate their status because, you know, we have this close relationship with them, and now we can start backing some of this up with science as well.
So interesting, David. I learned a number of disturbing things about the terrible impact Katrina had on pets. Now, you noted that 1,800 people perished, 250,000 pets were left behind, and 150,000 of them died. Paint the picture of what happened to dogs and cats caught up in Katrina.
Yeah, that was a really fascinating story. I actually went down to New Orleans on the I can't remember, the 7th or the 8th anniversary of Hurricane Katrina, and spent some time with Charlotte Bass-Lilly, who heads an organization down there called Animal Rescue New Orleans, or ARNO. And she just told me some really amazing stories. She was one of the people. She lived in New Orleans, and she stayed behind in the aftermath of the storm. She was one of these people that was wading through knee-deep water, getting sick, and breaking into houses to free cats and dogs. And what had happened is a lot of people did not evacuate. The helicopters would come, the boats would come, and they'd say, we can take you, the rescuers would say, we could take you, but we're not going to take your pets. And a lot of people said, well, then I'm not going. This is a member of my family. I'm not going to leave them behind. And actually, a lot of those people ended up dying. But some people did leave, and they left their pets behind. And a lot of them were under the impression that they'd be able to come back to their houses just a few days later. And what happened is They were kept out for a month, and so a lot of these animals ended up starving to death, or they ended up on the street and becoming feral and homeless. And so you had rescuers coming into the city and trying to save a lot of them, but a lot of these animals died. So, you know, I really document a lot of the heartbreaking stories in the book, but there was a lot of amazing stories of rescue as well.
How many people died in New Orleans because they would not leave their pets behind?
Probably hundreds of people, actually. There was a poll that was conducted after the storm, and it suggested that nearly half of the people that stayed behind because of their pets. And we know, as you mentioned, Lori, almost a couple thousand people died. So that could translate, actually, into quite a few people. We'll never know for sure, but it appears that it could have been actually hundreds of people that died because they stayed behind because of their pets.
And new laws resulted from the tragedy of Katrina, right?
That was one of the really amazing things. That's one of the big reasons I wanted to write about this. In the aftermath of the storm, Congress actually passed what's called the Pets Evacuation Transport Standards Act, or the PETS Act, which was passed in 2006. This is remarkable because this is a time, Congress is very divided today too, but Congress is incredibly divided at that period in time. We had the Iraq War going on. We had just a lot of really bitter partisan battles. But this was a bill that Congress almost unanimously got behind and passed this bill, which basically impels rescuers to save pets as well as people in natural disasters, which is really remarkable. And also since Katrina, we've seen more than a couple dozen states pass their own versions of this law. And so now when you have natural disasters, you'll have shelters that will take cats and dogs, which didn't happen before. You'll have transport for cats and dogs out of the city, which you didn't have before. And ideally, you'll have rescuers when they save people, they'll be saving pets as well.
Great. David, now let's go back a bit to the origins of the ASPCA and an incredible figure, Henry Berg. Please tell us about him.
Yeah, Henry Berg is this amazing guy. This is in the mid-1800s, and he has this remarkable experience. He's a very wealthy New York socialite. He was appointed by Abraham Lincoln to be basically the U.S. ambassador in Russia, and while he's in Russia, he sees a horse being beaten very cruelly on the streets of Russia, and this is a guy who didn't consider himself an animal lover. He was an avid meat eater, didn't really think about animals that much, but something goes off in his mind when he sees his horse being savagely beaten on the streets of St. Petersburg in Russia, and he just makes up his mind. He's like, I found my mission in life. My mission is not to be a diplomat. My mission is to be a savior for the animals. And he goes back to New York, and of course, around this time, there were no cars, and New York ran on thousands and thousands of horses, and they were really run into the ground. It was cheaper to work a horse to death and then just buy a new one than actually properly care for a horse. So you had horses dying by the hundreds, by the thousands in the streets, just being savagely beaten and left for dead. So in 1866, Henry Berg gets together a lot of his wealthy friends and a lot of politicians he knows, and he forms the ASPCA, and its primary mission is really to save horses, but he starts talking about saving other animals. He starts talking about dog fighting and cock fighting and other forms of cruelty, and he actually has his own, he's actually given his own police force, which is remarkable. He has a private police force that goes around the streets of New York and busts people for animal cruelty. He secures the first convictions for animal cruelty in the country. He passes the first law, which is, it makes it a misdemeanor for animal cruelty. And then what happens at the turn of the 20th century, when horses begin to disappear because of the rise of the automobile, the ASPCA goes, oh boy, what is our mission anymore? Our mission was primarily horses. And Henry Berg has died at this point, but the organization starts noticing you've got all these cats and dogs on the street. They're suffering on the street. They're being very cruelly euthanized. New York used to euthanize its dogs by essentially rounding them up in steel cages and dunking the cages into the East River to the dogs drown. So it was very horrific. So the ASPC steps in and starts being a champion for welfare for cats and dogs, which still is its primary mission today, even though it does care for other animals. You know, this mission that started with horses really transformed into a mission for cats and dogs. And these misdemeanor laws that Henry Berg helped pass, which were passed in a variety of states, have now become felony laws. And now in all 50 states, animal cruelty is a felony. So what really began with the ASPCA has become a very massive animal welfare situation today.
David, in the last minute before the break, you know, another reflection of the greater legal status for companion animals is the increasing number of pet custody legal cases and how much they mirror child custody cases. Briefly, what did you discover about them?
What's really interesting about the custody cases is that cats and dogs are technically property. Legally, they're no different in the United States than a couch or a toaster. So when a couple divorces, if they fight over the car, the judge will go, okay, well, you get the car, you get the couch, you know, or, you know, we'll sell the car and you'll split the money. But what we've seen recently in custody cases is a judge will talk about the best interests of the animal like you would for a child. So which home would the dog be happiest in? Which house would the cat be better cared for? And starting to make decisions based on what the animal feels, which you would never do for any of the other piece of property. And that's why I was really fascinated with custody cases. There's been some really remarkable ones that I document in the book. And just judges really recognizing that these animals really aren't property, that they are something more than property, and that their feelings need to be taken into account in these custody cases as well.
Very good. Don't go away. More with David Grimm. The book is called Citizen Canine, Our Evolving Relationship with Cats and Dogs. You're listening to Animals Today.
Walking through the streets of Soho in the rain.
As temperatures climb, please remember to never leave your dog in the car, not even for a minute on a warm day with the windows cracked and in the shade. The temperature inside a car can climb up in a matter of minutes, and it's enough to kill your pet. If you love your pet, leave them at home or with someone you trust. Keep them cool, comfortable, and alive. And if you see a dog or other pet in a car, you may only have a moment to save their life. Here are a couple of steps that you should remember. Make an announcement in the store or business the car is parked nearest to, and call the police department or animal control right away. Remember, it only takes a minute or two on a hot day to kill an animal left inside a car. Your swift action can save a life. Dogs are unable to cool themselves the way people can. Never leave your dog in the car, not even for a minute.
This message is sponsored by Advancing the Interests of Animals. You can check them out at aianimals.org. That's the letter A, I, animals.org.
Hi, this is Dr. Lori Kirshner from Advancing the Interests of Animals. And here are a few more ways you can be kind to animals, beginning with this. Report suspected animal abuse or neglect. If you see an underfed dog or an animal left in a car on a hot day, report it right away. You could be saving a life. Try a vegetarian diet, even just for a week. Decreasing and then stopping consumption of animals is probably the best way to show your appreciation for them and for the environment, too. Don't buy cosmetics or household products that have been tested on animals. That's easy these days. And finally, don't wear clothing made from animals. Begin by saying no to fur and gradually give up animal products like leather and wool. It's easier than you might imagine. This message is sponsored by Advancing the Interests of Animals. Please visit us at aianimals.org. That's aianimals.org.
What is term life insurance? It's basically a financial protection plan for your family if you pass away. It can be a hard purchase. Think about it. It's one of the few major purchases you can make that you will personally never use. But you've got to have it to protect your family. And you owe it to yourself to shop and compare to get the best possible rates. For term life insurance policies of $500,000 or more, call the Term Lifeline today.
800-957-6068. That's 800-957-6068. Remember, we specialize in term life insurance policies of $500,000 or more, and we have great rates for smokers too. So call today. 800-957-6068. 800-957-6068. That's 800-957-6068.
Geico presents Strange Savings Stories. Sam Tucker woke to find crop circles in his cornfield that spelled out the word Geico. Was this a message sent by aliens? Sam went to Geico.com and saved hundreds of dollars with great discounts. He woke the next day to find new crop patterns had formed. They spelled out, "You the man." It seems the aliens were pleased indeed.
Geico. 15 minutes could save you 15% or more on car insurance.
So what brought you in today?
Well, doctor, whenever I get excited, I yodel.
Interesting. So if I said Kmart and Sears are giving Shop Your Way members up to $20 in surprise points. Wow. And if I were to say surprise points can be used on qualifying purchases both in-store or online. And the points are only valid until June 11th? Amazing.
amazing.
I know. I'm not even Swiss.
Amount of points awarded based on membership status and other factors. See shopyourway.com for details.
Welcome back. We're speaking to David Grimm, author of the book Citizen Canine, Our Evolving Relationship with Cats and Dogs. David, what do you think the impact of Peter Singer's 1975 book Animal Liberation has been? And is it fully appreciated?
You know, I think it's obviously had a huge impact on the animal rights and even the animal welfare community. High-profile woman who you may have probably spoken to, Joyce Tischler, who heads the Animal Legal Defense Fund, and she was very inspired by the book. And in fact, what was really interesting talking to her, and I spent some time with her at an ALDF conference in Portland a couple years ago, was that she was really thinking a lot about cats and dogs, but she wasn't really sure how to write about them. She was in law school, and she read Animal Liberation, and all of a sudden gave her this language to really talk about rights for cats and dogs. And she was a very early proponent of stronger welfare, of, you know, maybe even something a little bit like personhood for these animals, which really nobody was talking about at the time. So, you know, Animal Liberation didn't just inspire people in terms of, you know, animal rights, in terms of, you know, factory farming and caged animals and research animals. It, you know, inspired people like Joyce Tischler, who was really thinking a lot about companion animals as well.
You know, as much as we admire and respect our own veterinarians, the American Veterinary Medical Association and the state veterinary associations actively oppose almost all animal welfare legislative initiatives, David. What do you make of that?
Well, what they're really opposed to is they're opposed to rights and they're opposed to personhood. And, you know, I wanted to be a veterinarian when I grew up. So, you know, I certainly see where they're coming from in some respects. I think veterinarians are in a very tricky situation because, on the one hand, it's very much to their advantage to treat this relationship we have with our pets as a familial relationship. When I was just in the vet a couple weeks ago, and the vet said to my cat, she said, you know, it's okay, Dad's going to take care of you. And she was referring to me. And obviously, it's very much to their advantage to have us view our pets as children, because that's the only way we're going to spend hundreds of dollars or thousands of dollars, in my case, on animals that we got maybe for a few bucks from a shelter. But the problem they have is when we go to the courtroom and we sue them for malpractice, if they make a mistake, all of a sudden that animal is a toaster again. That animal is only worth $50. And, you know, they're very concerned about being hit with large malpractice lawsuits, which has already started to happen. They've been sued successfully sometimes for tens of thousands of dollars for malpractice. So the AVMA is very concerned about that. But I think they really can't continue to have it both ways, you know, that it's going to be continually be a very tricky situation for them. They can't, you know, act like these animals are like our children in the clinic, but then pretend like they're toasters in the courtroom. And I think that the AVMA is really struggling with that issue.
Hmm. Do you feel the quest for greater rights for non-human animals is analogous to the abolition of slavery? You know, some people...
Well, you know, I don't take a position on that. I'm a journalist, so I really, I really approach this topic from a very journalistic standpoint, which means people that definitely feel that really ALDF, but obviously one who very much, you know, but also people in the AVMA. The personhood is incredibly bad. It's going to destroy biomedical research and meat production and all this other stuff. So one of the great things about writing the book was really being able to broach these topics, which are very controversial, and you have very strong voices on both sides, and sort of see this through the eyes of cats and dogs, and how, you know, our relationship with these animals is really bringing up these issues and bringing up a lot of strong emotions on both sides.
You know, one of my personal interests is encouraging people who have dogs and cats as family members to expand their interests and concerns to include other animals, and that includes wild animals and farmed animals. But telling a dog lover to think twice about eating a steak usually doesn't get us very far. So I see the fact that we eat other animals as a big roadblock animal rights movement. What do you think?
Well, you know, I think what's really interesting is we've seen these interesting polls come out. For example, American support for animal research has really plummeted over the past 15 years. I think it was maybe about only 29% of Americans opposed animal testing in 2000, and I think The poll was conducted last year that it was maybe up to 41%, and it, I believe it's over 50% for the younger age group. I think people under 30, and nobody really knows why that is. But I think, you know, I think dogs and cats play a role with that. You know, we in the last couple of decades, especially, we really treated these animals like family members on a very broad social scale. We have a lot of a very strong bond with these animals. We have a lot of empathy for these animals. And I think that it's allowing people, especially the younger generation, which really grew up with these animals kind of as virtual siblings, to start seeing other animals through the eyes of their cats and dogs. You know, they can all of a sudden maybe have a little bit more empathy for that elephant at the zoo or the, you know, the lab rat in the lab. I don't know how any of that's going to translate over to vegetarianism or veganism. I don't know if it will cross that bridge or not. But I do think we're seeing more empathy for all animals. And I really do believe a large reason for that is because of the relationship we have with the animals in our homes.
Yeah, so interesting. David, you write about law professor and animal rights crusader Stephen Weiss, leader of the Non-Human Rights Project. We've also had him on our show. The Non-Human Rights Project has three lawsuits in New York State on behalf of four chimps, arguing that they have the right to bodily liberty, meaning that they have the right not to be imprisoned. Are you following these cases, and would you comment briefly on their importance?
Yeah, I'm definitely following these cases. I actually wrote a story about those New York lawsuits for Science Magazine, which I work for. And I've talked to Steve a few times on the phone. I think what's really interesting about those arguments is he's making very intellectual arguments to these judges, saying, you know, when, especially when he talks about chimpanzees, that these animals, us, they share most of our DNA. I think they think a lot like us, much like us, and intellectually it makes sense for them not to be in captivity because they probably suffer the same way we would suffer. And I think what's interesting is, you know, I really argue in the book that any animal is going to get personhood. It's not these, it's going to be cats and dogs. And the reason I say that is because I, you know, and not that I agree with that or disagree with that, but the reason I think that that's more likely a possibility. First of all, we've already seen custody cases and emotional distress damages and felony anti-cruelty laws for dogs and cats, and you're not seeing that as much or prosecuted as much for other animals, even chimpanzees. But also the fact that, you know, judges think with their hearts as well as their minds. And I think when the judge goes home at night, he has that cat or dog in his bed. You know, he doesn't have a chimpanzee in his bed. And I think it's much easier for judges and politicians to view cats and dogs more like people, whether they're going to give them rights or not, to see them more like people than maybe that, that chimpanzee in the cage. And again, not that that's right or wrong, but, you know, that my personal bias, and of course, I'm writing about cats and dogs, so that would be my bias, but I really do think that, you know, and I think we've seen evidence for that, that more movement actually may come on the companion animal front than comes on the chimpanzee front or the elephant front or even the whale and dolphin front.
I want to thank David Grimm. His book is titled Citizen Canine, Our Evolving Relationship with Cats and Dogs. David, thanks for coming on the show.
Thank you so much.
I wish I could be as carefree and wild, but I got cat class and I got cat style.
Hi, Hi, this is Dr. Lori Kirshner, and I want to thank you for listening to Animals Today. Make sure to visit us on animalstodayradio.com, where you will see all our previous shows, and you can download them free. That's animalstodayradio.com. Also, make sure to become a friend on Facebook. Animals Today gets a lot of its support from the nonprofit group Advancing the Interests of Animals. Check them out at aianimals.org. And I hope you'll consider making a donation to help pay for the ongoing broadcast of Animals Today. Each week on Animals Today, we strive to bring you the highest quality, most up-to-date information about all animal welfare topics, and we certainly would appreciate your support. That website again is aianimals.org. And thanks for listening.
This alert just came in. This special announcement is for business owners and leaders of organizations who've been waiting for the right time to build. General Steel has made it impossible to wait any longer with rock-bottom prices that could save you thousands. That's right. General Steel, America's leader in pre-engineered structures, is offering buildings at prices you will never see again. Don't miss these prices. A 50 by 100 for under $30,000. You heard right. That's 5,000 square feet under $30,000. Manufacturers, if you need a larger building, try a 100 by 100 commercial building for $129,000. You can't afford to rent with these prices. Imagine a 70 by 100 foot church building for under $69,000. With the economy improving and interest rates still at historic lows, you can't afford to wait.
Call 800-605-5370. 800-605-5370. Call 800-605-5370.
If you're struggling to pay or haven't been making your student loan payments, listen carefully to this urgent alert. Have you been out of school for 10 or more years and you're still making your student loan payments? Are your student loans past due or even in default? Can't go back to school because of an old student loan problem? Fast Track Student Loans can get your student loans out of default, stop any wage garnishments, stop collection calls, and stop seizure of your tax refund. Give yourself a break. Stop the stress and get your student loan payments down to as little as $25 a month based on what you can afford to pay. One quick 10-minute call could help you solve your student loan problems. So call right now. Not available in all states. Payments may vary based on income.
800-685-0129. 800-685-0129. 800-685-0129. That's 800-685-0129.
At last, Nexium, the purple pill, is available without a prescription for frequent heartburn. See those women drinking their iced mocha whatevers? Now they have Nexium-level protection. That guy struggling to text and eat soup at the same time? Him too. Introducing Nexium 24 Hour, the protection of the number one prescribed acid-blocking brand, just without the prescription. New Nexium 24 Hour. Nexium level protection, now in the heartburn aisle.
May take 1 to 4 days. Use as directed to treat frequent heartburn, not for immediate relief.
At last, Nexium, the purple pill, is available without a prescription for frequent heartburn. See those women drinking their iced mocha whatevers? Now they have Nexium level protection. That guy struggling to text and eat soup at the same time? Him too. Introducing Nexium 24 Hour, the protection of the number one prescribed acid-blocking brand, just without the prescription. New Nexium 24 Hour. Nexium level protection, now in the heartburn aisle.
May take 1 to 4 days. Use as directed to treat frequent heartburn, not for immediate relief.
So what brought you in today?
Well, doctor, whenever I get excited, I yodel.
Interesting. So if I said Kmart and Sears are giving Shop Your Way members up to $20 in surprise points. Wow. And if I were to say surprise points can be used on qualifying purchases both in-store or online. And the points are only valid until June 11th? Amazing!
I know. I'm not even Swiss.
Amount of points awarded based on membership status and other factors. See ShopYourWay.com for details.
Got pain? Get Zim's Max Freeze. Zim's Max Freeze. Maximum muscle and joint pain relief. Your solution for temporary relief of aches and pains. Zim's Max Freeze knows your pain and relieves backaches, strains, bruises, and sprains. If you're a senior, weekend warrior, or seasoned athlete, get Zim's Max Freeze. Zim's Max Freeze is fast-acting and deep-penetrating with no lingering odor. Available at all major retailers.
back to animals today. We recently learned the Green Party of British Columbia has taken a stand against rodeos in the province. To learn more, we are pleased to welcome Peter Fricker, Projects and Communications Director, Vancouver Humane Society. Welcome to the program, Peter.
Hi, Lori. Thanks for having me.
Okay, Peter, the Green Party is in British Columbia is calling for a ban on rodeos in the province. What is the Green Party, and how large is it, and what are its interests?
It's a relatively small and fairly new political party in British Columbia. There are several other Green Parties in other provinces, and there's a national, federal Green Party as well. And they basically emulated the Green Party movement in Europe, which focuses on improving the environment. But the Green Party here has also adopted a number of other progressive positions, including this one on rodeo.
Peter, what is the relationship between the Vancouver Humane Society and the Green Party?
We actually don't have a direct relationship with the party. We just supplied information to one of their researchers on the issue, and they basically took that information and used it to develop the resolution, which essentially calls for a ban on rodeos throughout the province.
So how did this resolution come about, and what exactly does it mean to offer such a resolution?
One of their supporters was interested in the issue and got them to look into researching the whole issue, and that's where when we provided the information to their researchers. And what it essentially means is that that resolution means that that's the official position of the party going forward, and that that their membership supports the idea of a ban on rodeos in the province. But probably the most significant thing about it is that it's just another signal, another sign that public opinion is turning against rodeos, at least in this province. And it is the first time any political party in Canada has taken such a position publicly. So we're really pleased about it.
Yeah, that's exciting news. Peter, how popular are rodeos in British Columbia?
Well, there are a number of rodeos in mostly smaller communities throughout the interior of British Columbia where there are ranching communities and agricultural areas. But a recent poll near the end of 2013 showed that, in fact, the majority of British Columbians are opposed to rodeo. About 56% of respondents said that they were opposed to rodeo, and only 38% said they were in favor.
Tell us about the Cloverdale Rodeo and the reforms instituted there.
Yeah, the Cloverdale Rodeo is in Surrey, B.C., which is just outside Vancouver. And we had been campaigning against that rodeo for a number of years, almost a decade, I think. And then in 2007, after a lot of public pressure and a particular incident in which a calf broke its leg in the calf roping event and had to be euthanized, there was such an outcry that they decided they had to do something. And what they agreed to do was to drop four key offenses in the rodeo, which included calf roping, steer wrestling, team roping, and wild cow milking. So they were eliminated. And the rodeo has continued. And it's interesting because it's still a successful fair, even though it's basically down to half a rodeo. And we've used that as a model to approach other rodeos and say, look, you don't need all these cruel events. You can still have a country fair. And in fact, we think you can do without the rodeo entirely, but certainly they could have a successful country fair without all these very cruel events. So now the Cloverdale Rodeo is probably the least inhumane rodeo in North America. And yet it remains a successful community event in terms of being a country fair.
Now, every year we see the Calgary Stampede Rodeo with its huge crowds and corporate sponsors. The Vancouver Humane Society has campaigned against that as well. What is the status of those efforts?
Well, of course, that's a much bigger challenge because Calgary, Alberta is you know, it's part of its identity, rodeo, and in particular that rodeo, the Stampede. It's very famous. It's very well attended. Of course, rodeo is only one part of it. It's a huge event with celebrities and lots of other activities and entertainment and so on. And we focus just on the rodeo. We don't have any problem with the other events. But it is part and parcel of the Stampede's image, and therefore it's much more difficult. However, since we've been campaigning since about 2009, there has been massive amounts of public attention and media attention on that rodeo. And every time an animal dies there or is injured, it actually makes national news. So there's a huge amount of attention and pressure on the Stampede. And as a result, they have made a few changes to rules for events, including safer, tried to make the chuck wagon race there a bit safer. They've instituted what's called a no-jerk-down rule in calf roping. That's where the competitors are not allowed to basically pull the calf backwards off its feet, and if they do, they're penalized. Now, these are fairly minor things, and of course, we're not satisfied with that, but it does show that that rodeo is subject to public pressure, and they're sensitive to public opinion. So we're hoping that with continued pressure and the likelihood of more incidents there that are going to attract negative attention, that they may be forced to at least drop some of the events, perhaps calf roping. So we're going to keep the pressure up on them.
Now, the city of Vancouver banned rodeos in 2006. Was that hard to achieve?
Not particularly, because there had been rodeos in the city in the past as part of the Pacific National Exhibition. They would occasionally have a big indoor rodeo, but it wasn't part of the city's heritage. However, it was really important to us to set a precedent for a major city in Canada to be the first to effectively ban rodeo, and that made news and set a good precedent. So all these things are sort of, you know, one by one, we're drawing attention to the issue and making progressive steps. And at least in British Columbia here and here on the coast, you know, there has to be an effect, and I think it was shown in that poll that these successes have gradually helped change public opinion, and we're hoping that will eventually spread across the country.
Yeah, the rodeos and the participants often refer to the animals as athletes, or that they treat them like family members. It's really insane, isn't it?
It is. They have all these various arguments, and they're quite easy to shoot down. I mean, in that one in particular, we always say, well, you know, human athletes have a choice in taking part in a risky event. The animals have no say in it at all. So, you know, we've researched this issue very thoroughly, looked at all the arguments, pros and cons, and we can pretty well counter almost all the arguments that the rodeo industry makes. But it's still difficult because, of course, the public in general and the media, you know, they don't focus in detail on all these things, and they only see the marketing and the headlines produced by the rodeo industry, and you've really got to get people to look at exactly what happens to these animals and point out that these risks and these injuries that the animals are subjected to and the cruelty they're subjected to are all just for the sake of entertainment. And what we've found is that when you can get people to actually look at the details, look at the photographs and the videos and so on, and apply a bit of common sense, they immediately do come over to our side, because once they're educated, I think no decent person can support this.
Yeah, that's the key, isn't it? It's really education, because a lot of people are just ignorant to the fact that rodeos are cruel. What will it take to eliminate rodeos in BC or other Canadian provinces, and is it possible?
I think so. I mean, we certainly know it's going to take time, and sometimes it's a matter of just plugging away. And then you get a break. There's some kind of incident that people are just appalled by. The sad thing is that as far as the media is concerned, it's when there's an animal that's injured or killed or some terrible accident with the chuck wagons and a number of horses are killed, that's what draws public attention. And, of course, we don't want to see that happen. But, unfortunately, it's incidents like those that do draw the public's attention and get them to understand that these things shouldn't be allowed. basically what we're going to do is just carry on campaigning using, you know, different tactics and anything we can do to draw the public's attention to the issue.
Peter, what's the website of your organization?
It's vancouverhumanesociety.bc.ca.
Peter Fricker, thank you for coming on the show, and good luck in your work against the rodeos and your other campaigns. We appreciate it.
Thank you so much.
That's the sound of a dog whose vocal cords were cut just to stifle her voice. It's called devocalization, and it's done to cats as well. Devocalized animals rasp and wheeze, cough and gag the rest of their lives. Some are rendered mute. And for what? So a commercial or hobby breeder can keep many animals without having to listen to them. So show dogs will be quiet in transit between shows or in the ring. So an irresponsible pet owner can leave a dog alone for hours every day. Animals today joins with Coalition to Protect and Rescue Pets in saying shame on anyone who would have a dog or cat devocalized, and shame on the vets who perform this inhumane, unnecessary surgery for them. Please speak out against devocalization of dogs and cats. Use your voice. Protect theirs. This message is sponsored by Advancing the Interests of Animals. You can check them out at AIAnimals.org.
Geico presents Strange Savings Stories. Sam Tucker woke to find crop circles in his cornfield that spelled out the word Geico. Was this a message sent by aliens? Sam went to Geico.com and saved hundreds of dollars with great discounts. He woke the next day to find new crop patterns had formed. They spelled out, "You the man." It seems the aliens were pleased indeed.
Geico. 15 minutes could save you 15% or more on car insurance.
Got pain? Get Zim's Max Freeze. Zim's Max Freeze. Maximum muscle and joint pain relief. Your solution for temporary relief of aches and pains. Zim's Max Freeze knows your pain and relieves backaches, strains, bruises, and sprains. If you're a senior, weekend warrior, or seasoned athlete, get Zim's Max Freeze. Zim's Max Freeze is fast-acting and deep-penetrating with no lingering odor. Available at all major retailers.
Geico presents a man who just saved on his motorcycle insurance.
First off, my name is Daryl. Second, this is no motorcycle. This monster is 1,100 cc's of raw internal combustion power.
Feel the ground shake!
Now, I know what you're thinking. Where's this science teacher's logical attitude that goes with his sensible sneakers? Well, Mr. Rains on my parade, I saved a bunch on motorcycle insurance with Geico. Now, if you'll excuse me, I've got some young minds that need molding.
Geico Motorcycle. See how much you could save.
So what brought you in today?
Well, doctor, whenever I get excited, I yodel.
Interesting. So if I said Kmart and Sears are giving Shop Your Way members up to $20 in surprise points. And if I were to say surprise points can be used on qualifying purchases both in-store or online. And the points are only valid until June 11th? Amazing!
I know. I'm not even Swiss.
Amount of points awarded based on membership status and other factors. See ShopYourWay.com for details.
Owe $10,000 or more to the IRS that you can't pay? Call now for immediate help. 866-657-8517. At Community Tax Relief, we help consumers like you. If you take on the IRS alone, you could be facing levies, liens, even wage garnishments, personal or business tax issues. If you owe the IRS $10,000 or more, they will aggressively come after you. Protect yourself and your family today from what the IRS can do to you. Call now. 866-657-8517. They can freeze your bank account, even garnish your wages. Our expert team of tax professionals can solve your tax problems once and for all. Call now for a free 5-minute tax debt analysis. 866-657-8517. 866-657-8517. 866-657-8517.
At last, Nexium, the purple pill, is available without a prescription for frequent heartburn. See those women drinking their iced mocha whatevers? Now they have Nexium-level protection. That guy struggling to text and eat soup at the same time? Him too. Introducing Nexium 24-Hour, the protection of the number one prescribed acid-blocking brand, just without the prescription. New Nexium 24-Hour. Nexium-level protection, now in the heartburn aisle.
May take 1 to 4 days. Use as directed to treat frequent heartburn, not for immediate relief.
At last, Nexium, the purple pill, is available without a prescription for frequent heartburn. See those women drinking their iced mocha whatevers? Now they have Nexium-level protection. That guy struggling to text and eat soup at the same time? Him too. Introducing Nexium 24-Hour, the protection of the number one prescribed acid-blocking brand, just without the prescription. New Nexium 24-Hour. Nexium-level protection, now in the heartburn aisle.
May take 1 to 4 days. Use as directed to treat frequent heartburn, not for immediate relief.
Welcome back to Animals Today. Hello, Peter.
Hey, Lori. How you doing?
Good. What's in the news?
The Pope had some comments about pets this week.
I read about that.
He is facing the decreased birth rate in Italy, and he's concerned about that apparently, although he didn't connect it. But he is advising couples not to put off having children and not to use pets as substitutes or replacements for loving a child. And a lot of people are taken aback by that. So he is encouraging couples not to think it's a good idea, that he doesn't want them to delay having children or not having children and substitute them for cats and dogs as pets. He thinks they're, if you do this, you're at risk to become old and live a life of solitude and bitterness and loneliness.
If you substitute dogs and cats for kids.
Yes.
Okay.
So.
Too late for us.
Too late.
Okay.
In Spain, in the Canary Islands, in a zoo there, they were having a drill, and a gorilla escape drill. So in this drill, they have a guy dressed up in a gorilla suit, and they try to figure out what they're going to do. And he was accidentally shot with an actual tranquilizer gun as part of this drill.
Oh, my.
The details are a little sketchy.
Wow.
But somehow a live person received a full dose of tranquilizer designed to neutralize a 440-pound gorilla.
What happened to the guy?
What happened to the guy is that luckily the vet injected the antidote into him right away, and he went to the intensive care unit where he slept for 8 hours and spent a couple of days there and apparently recovered fully.
Great.
So
having nice bear dreams while he was sleeping.
It's incredible. I mean, remarkable that he just didn't die right there.
Oh,
I
know.
The antidote, you know.
Yeah. Wow.
So.
And how does that happen?
You know what? I'm trying to find details, but they are not forthcoming.
Right.
You know. So,
lesson learned: don't dress up in a bear suit during a bear drill.
I know. At least have. Right. Don't. That's the best lesson. Don't be the guy.
Yeah, exactly.
So, I'll dress in the. Right. I thought you would say, okay, lesson learned, don't use real tranquilizer. Okay, don't be the guy.
Right.
Sad story here. A legal settlement finally came to a conclusion between the family of a 2-year-old who was fatally mauled in a Pittsburgh zoo a couple of years ago. He fell or was dropped into a wild dog habitat. You remember that? And
yeah.
He was... mauled and died rather quickly. The dogs are very aggressive, and there was no chance to save this kid. So in a the details have not been disclosed, but the legal actions are done. Apparently the zoo countersued the family. There were no criminal charges brought against either party, but in the civil suit, the family sued the zoo, claiming various things, bad enclosure, right?
Right.
Not enough, the wall was not high enough, whatever. And then the zoo countersued, and the settlement was finally reached. Pretty sad story.
terribly sad. So do we know if the child just slipped through fence, or was he really dropped by his parents?
Yeah, the facts, some of the facts are pretty clear.
Yeah.
The child lunged or was being held too close to the railing, and a combination of moved and slipped and ended up in there.
Wow.
And the enclosure is approved by the AZA, and that probably led to the settlement. But clearly, there should be no way a kid should be able to get in there.
No way.
Even if the parents make a mistake, do a Michael Jackson move or whatever.
Right.
It should just not be possible.
Right.
Well, the dogs are out, and they have been replaced by cheetahs now in the enclosure. So
if a child slips through, the cheetahs are going to...
They're going to go over and just lick him and push him back over.
Exactly.
So everything's fine.
Okay, so lesson learned here is no zoos.
Right. That's right.
That's right.
I mean, I don't know.
I know. It's really tragedy.
Hedgehogs are becoming a popular pet. I'm just stating that because it boggles the mind why you would want to pay $50 to $200 for a hedgehog that sleeps most of the day. It's a little a prickly little thing, and they are being bred to be sold and live a boring life in a cage and die an early death and give you salmonella.
I think this is terrible.
Yeah, that's the latest sort of thing.
Really?
Yeah.
I had no idea.
Well, it's
legal in all states?
Well, I don't know if it's legal, but they are alleged to be fun to watch. They're quiet. They're not aggressive. They're easy to care for. They don't smell much. And
let's cage them up.
Let's cage them up.
Yeah.
Right. So that's the pop. There you go.
But, you know, so a lot of questions raised, though, because they're still considered wild animals, and a lot of states ban the exotic or wild animals as pets.
I bet, but they're pretty small.
Okay.
They probably look
like a hamster type.
Yeah, that's what that's probably how they're regarded.
Yeah.
And you can mail order hedgehogs.
Really?
Yeah.
This is crazy.
I know.
This is crazy.
But the beat goes on because in New York City, you know, there's a ferret ban. You can't have a ferret. Apparently, do you know, in California, ferrets as pets are prohibited in Hawaii and also some cities, including New York. The health department has banned it. They've been banned for a long time. But there are lots of underground ferrets. There's a big ferret trade.
Oh.
And but people are very quiet about whether they have a ferret, which is a big rodent. So the mayor is expressed possible interest in looking into this.
Wow.
As one of his major initiatives. So... And we've talked about ferrets and people, when they bring them to the vet, they don't tell anybody they're bringing their ferret, and they try to disguise it as a cat.
They disguise their ferret as a cat?
Well, not with a costume, but they just they don't want to be ferreted out as a vet.
Okay.
So that's what's happening in the world of animal news.
Thank you.
Okay,
check out Animals Today on the website, animalstoderadio.com.
That's right.
Sponsored by the nonprofit organization Advancing the Interests of Animals, AIAnimals.org.
AIAnimals.org.
Very good. And thank you, Peter. Thank you, listeners, for listening to the show. This is Dr. Lori Kirshner encouraging you to nurture your love and compassion for the only other beings sharing our planet, the animals.
The opinions you hear on Biz Talk Radio are those of the hosts, callers, and guests, and do not necessarily reflect those of this station, Biz Talk Radio, its management, or advertisers. The information on Biz Talk Radio does not constitute a recommendation, offer, or solicitation to buy or sell any product or service. If you have any questions about Biz Talk Radio, contact us at 817-274-1609 or at biztalkradio.com.
USA News, I'm Bill Morrison. A Pentagon psychologist says returned captives typically take anywhere from 5 days to 3 weeks to go through the process of reintegration, in which Sergeant Bo Bergdahl now finds himself. A senior U.S. official says Bergdahl has told people treating him at a U.S. military medical facility in Germany that he was tortured, beaten, and held in a cage after trying to escape from his Taliban captors in Afghanistan. The New York Times reports doctors say Bergdahl is...